And joining us for our second hot copy, we have former advisor to government's COVID-19 task force and health reform advocate, Dr. Anthony Leachon. Good morning, doctor, and thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning. Good morning.
First of all, President Duterte due to make an announcement today about the quarantine guidelines. Have you spoken with the president, and did you agree with the GCQ call of Metro Manila mayors to the end of the year?
Well, I have not spoken to the president, only some of the members of the IATF and some of the local government unit leaders in Metro Manila. And I think decision would be a retention of the GCQ in the National Capital Region and in some hotspot areas so that you can actually, curb the viral transmission. And at the same time, inform the public that they should actually adhere to the minimum health standards, considering the threat of a surge during the holiday season because of social mobility as we reopen the economy.
Mm-mm. Yeah. So you do agree with the GCQ call. And social mixing, is seen to be driving a second wave of infection in North America and Europe. And up to November 23 here, the Philippines has been able to maintain a low production number of 0.83 or under 1, a national recovery rate of 92.7%. What does this tell you, doctor? And by how much could social gatherings threaten this reproduction and recovery rate?
Well, I think the Philippines, particularly the civil society, has been compliant with the IATF and the National Task Force guidelines in terms of wearing face masks and face shield and social distancing. I think the reproduction number is below 1, but as you can see, it's also increasing, 0.7 to 0.83, but still less than 1. And if we will not be very focused, then we will fall into the problem of another surge. As you can see right now, there are hotspots in areas outside of the National Capital Region. And the main epicenter right now is actually the Davao City. So this is my analysis of this particular data at this point in time. We are not yet out of the woods, given the social mobility that will be happening in the last quarter of the year because of the holiday season. And there will be some after effects of the typhoons because of some of the citizens are there in the evacuation centers. And 2 or 3 typhoons are threatening to come in the last quarter of the year. So we must be very, very focused on these items.
And since then, there has been a slight uptick in the number of cases. You mentioned the Okta Research Group still cannot quite attribute the pandemic fatigue or recent typhoons. Should we be grateful that temperature or climate is not quite a factor right now, except for the typhoons, which we are expecting more of until the end of the year? How do we best control numbers moving forward? How do we remain focused, as you say?
Well, if we were only consider the temperature, I have a projection that it may actually be a problem also, because as you approach the holiday season, the temperature will drop. And based on experience and, of course, overindulgence over the holiday season, you might actually experience also an uptick of cardiovascular cases. And these are the patients more vulnerable to COVID infection. So what I'm saying, there will be a confluence of problems in the last quarter, considering you will have influenza, you can have dengue fever, you can have pneumonia, and then a surge of the COVID cases because of social mobility problems and after effect of the typhoons. And then you have a surge as well of cardiovascular cases happening during the holiday season. So I think we should be more or less forward-looking in terms of trying to contain these factors, a balance between the healthy or preventive lifestyle at the same time, following also the minimum health standards to curb viral transmission.
And this is the one that you're referring to as a tridemic, is that correct?
Right, tridemic in the sense that for many years prior to the coming of the COVID, we know that after the Thanksgiving in the United States and even here in the Philippines with the first day of December up to January 6, there's usually an increase of strokes and heart attack, picking up on December 25, 26, and then December 31 and January. So a lot of things. And then the prediction of many that there will be a surge of COVID cases because of social mobility problem. And of course, an increase in the cases of influenza and pneumonia because of the low temperature that we'll be experiencing in the holidays.
Right. Family gatherings, of course, should be limited in size. Already, though, on social media, we can see that people have begun to gather with nary any physical distancing. How dangerous is that, and who are the most vulnerable?
The single most effective intervention measure is actually social distancing, and that has been proven in many articles. And then, of course, you had the face shield and the face mask. It's very effective in terms of curbing transmission. And how do you contain it? Well, we have to limit it to about 10. And everybody should step up to the plate and sacrifice at home, in the workplace, in the community. And we should be, we should encourage the government to put some measures into this, because I think in other countries like the United States, they have a stay-home order in LA right now and other countries. In South Korea, I just saw the newspaper that they will be following the same advisory in America. And I think we should do that also. I think we need certain strong measures in order to control the crowd. We see right now problems in some shopping areas, and I think as we draw close to the holidays, this will be a problem.
What about the proposal of some businessmen to actually be under GCQ, but loosen the age eligibility to go out? How would you feel about that?
I think we need to maintain this. You know, the vulnerable is actually the senior citizens, particularly those with comorbid conditions, hypertension and diabetes. I think as long as the senior citizens are able to protect themselves and they feel that these are essential travels, and these are, you know, sporadic and not every day, and this will be okay. I'm also worried about the kids being allowed to go out, and they say that the holiday season is about kids and children. But I think if they will be allowed to roam around and visit the malls, they will be the ones that will carry the virus at home, and they will be the super spreaders, and that will affect their parents as well as their grandparents. So this is dangerous. This has been happening in other countries where the children are actually the super spreaders in the home and, of course, in other areas.
So we should keep it to 15 to 65 years old.
Right. I would maintain 15 to 65.
If it couldn't be helped that there's some kind of social gathering, what is the optimum number, doctor? Is it really 10 people in GCQ areas? And what about in closed spaces?
I think 10 is the optimum number. And if we can actually be, if we can enforce less than that, the better. I think we have been compliant with that, and I think that's the number that we should follow. In close contact area, it should be, it depends on the space, but I would say that it should not be more than 10 in an ordinary room area.
What protocols can people follow so that they don't end up helping spread the virus? Perhaps more mandatory testing if you know you're going to a gathering, non-buffet style eating. We often talk about problems that ensue from a lack of observance of the quarantine protocols, but what would be the ideal scenario?
The ideal scenario is to have a mindset of a visionary, a mindset of a person that will actually protect himself and also the family. And basically, it would start by allowing yourself to have a kit. You have a kit or a bag that would contain your mask, your face shield, and of course your alcohol and everything. And a mindset that you should actually maintain 1 up to 3 meters of distancing. As long as you adhere to this, I think you can do a lot of things. And we have seen this, that it has been working for the last 3 months for the Philippines. And I don't think it will be different in the last quarter of the year. But unfortunately, we have seen cases of violation of physical distancing. It's not only coming from civil society, but as well as from government leaders. And I think this must be addressed at the soonest time possible, because this will be a problem in terms of implementation.
Meanwhile, this first move of the government and the private sector to secure vaccines from AstraZeneca on the same day that it announced plans to conduct further trials on the efficacy of its vaccine after an alleged dosing error, Thailand bought even more doses. Now, you, Dr. Leachon, having been part of a pharmaceutical firm yourself, do you believe it is a wise move?
Well, I should have been more cautious considering AstraZeneca is facing problems right now with their dosing schedule. These are the items that I'd like to reflect on. Last October, the AstraZeneca clinical trial was put on hold, and the regulatory agencies finally resumed the study, and they said that it's not dose related. But how come that from a full dose, then after 1 month, then you have a full dose, the efficacy was 62%. And then for 8,000 patients. And then they went on to do the 2,295 patients using a half dose and then a full dose, and then eliciting a 90% efficacy rate with an overall average of efficacy rate of 70%. This may actually be a problem in terms of lack of transparency. And I think Astra should be able to disclose that, particularly during the meeting on the tripartite deal signing. Mm-hmm. I mean, it should not be cast in stone. It should be refundable in the event that there might be some issues regarding safety. For the information of the public, only one company has been given the emergency use authorization, and that's Pfizer on December 10. I do hope, though, that it's not a fatal mistake for Astra regarding this particular dosing schedule. They said it's a lab error or a manufacturing process problem. But if ever the FDA and EMEA, that's the European Medical Agency, would require them to pursue another trial based on the half dose and then full dose to show the 90% efficacy rate, that will stall right now the procurement process and distribution for Thailand and the Philippines. But of course, we know that safety is paramount. But if ever the FDA would decide in their favor in the next few days or next few weeks, then they will be on time for the December approval, just like Pfizer and Moderna. We just do hope, because the AstraZeneca is a vaccine is welcome in poorer countries and low middle income countries, because there will be no problems in cold storage. It's relatively cheap and affordable than Pfizer and Moderna. And the efficacy rate is at least 70%. Since the expectation of the FDA is about 50 to 70%, I think the 70% would be good. Now, if they will be pursuing the half dose, then after 4 weeks full dose to elicit or trigger a 90% efficacy rate, then that will be good for the Philippines and Thailand.
But 60% is not acceptable.
It's Well, it will be low, of course, vis-a-vis Pfizer and Moderna because of the antibody response. I think Astra should go for another trial, just in case they will be approved based on this particular initial trial. Astra should do another trial to pursue the half dose and then full dose to get more than 90% efficacy rate, because this will be important in terms of influencing the public or the other countries to get their products, because right. increasing the efficacy rate would mean better antibody as well as better immunity response.
Earlier before this interview, we heard presidential advisor for entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion saying that indeed, the tripartite agreement, it is refundable. The money is refundable in case of any issues down the line. Now, can and should government make supply deals such as that for AstraZeneca vaccine, even without the emergency use authority? I remember you had a tweet on that saying that the EUA should be made available before any such purchases. But if we wait for it, you know, of course, we're going to be pushed down the line in terms of supply. How do we make that balance?
Well, the emergency use authorization is important for safety. Remember that there are two requirements, efficacy and safety. That's why Pfizer was not able to apply right away for the EUA, because they got only the efficacy rate of about 95%, but they don't have the safety data. You can only get the safety data 2 months after the finish of the trial. You will be given 2 months to observe any adverse event. Now, after securing the safety data, then they apply for EUA. So that will be a difficult problem for Astra if they will not be given the EUA, since it will be the one that will be submitted to their regulatory authorities here in the Philippines. And they will review that. We have a separate process, an EUA of 21 days. So if they don't have an EUA, I don't think they can get the market authorization or certificate of product approval. And this is very important considering you're going to vaccinate 70% of the population. And safety is more important than efficacy.
Now, government is saying that it is making purchases from different manufacturers, not just from AstraZeneca, and that these vaccines do have varying conditions they need to be in to be effective. You did mention cold chain issues. Is this move to not put all your eggs in one basket a common practice? And is it a prudent one in this case of trying to control a pandemic?
Well, it's a wise move that you should actually do multiple deals. Of course, the best approach is to get Astra, because number one is the efficacy rate is acceptable at 70%. And then number two, that's gold cold storage issues. Number three is affordable and cheap. And I think once the kinks on the safety issues and the dosing schedules or issues are resolved, I think that would be a nice move. But you need also to understand that you need to get also from Pfizer and Moderna and Johnson & Johnson and other companies, because of the global competition, they may not be able to supply bigger volumes of vaccine. So I think it would be good in the long run that we order from Pfizer or Moderna. Right now, Pfizer will be concentrated on America because of the soaring cases of COVID in America, and Moderna as well, because they have committed by signing an agreement with the administration on the warp speed. So therefore, they are obliged to serve USA and perhaps also part of Europe. And therefore, this will limit, of course, the availability of vaccines in the rest of the world. I think we have also deals with the Chinese Sinovac. That's also a good product. We just don't know when this particular compound will be submitted for FDA evaluation as well.
What about Russia's Sputnik V? We hear that the daughter of Russian President Vladimir Putin had already taken it, but months later, the president himself had not taken it. Are you hopeful that it is a viable option for the Philippines as a vaccine for COVID-19?
Well, I'm hopeful, but not very positive about it because of the lack of track record of Russian pharmaceutical industry and the lack of experience in vaccine development. And they also started vaccinating some patients prior to the FDA approval without submission of the regulatory and safety data to a regulatory agency. And we need to have this particular document reviewed by a peer-reviewed journal so that we can actually see the real picture. It's very difficult at this point in time, but any positive news that will actually increase the supplies for the Philippines will be welcome. But safety, of course, is very, very important.
The timing issues. Well, the U.S. says, you did mention earlier, it should be able to vaccinate at a rate of about 30 million people a month. And if they're targeting to reach two-thirds of their population, that's about 200 million, they should be done in about 6 to 7 months, starting December, the middle of December this year, and done with vaccinations by the middle of next year, which is only when we get our supply. Plus, we only get to finish it in 36 to 60 months, that's 3 to 5 years. We can surmise the answers to my next questions, Doctor, but perhaps it bears saying still, and best coming from you. Number one, how did the U.S. get priority access to the vaccines? And second, what does it take to accomplish that level of massive inoculations with the aim of reaching herd immunity?
Well, it's very easy for the U.S. to get that kind of vaccine since it's there in the U.S. and Pfizer is an American company and it's the number one company in the world right now. They may not have problems in terms of cold storage, sub-zero, because they are there. And of course, because of their investment in healthcare, they can afford really to supply the entire America in the soonest time possible. I think for us that we're limited, and they say that the vaccine plan is about 3 to 5 years. I have a different suggestion that perhaps the first initial volume that we will get, let's say from Astra or Pfizer or Moderna, let's consider that the National Capital Region has a population of 13 million and 70% of that is about 9 million. So I think we should not spread the vaccine distribution thinly. For example, I heard about plans of vaccinating, let's say, Cebu or Davao. Mind you that we need to vaccinate 70% of the population. And for us, I think the focus should be National Capital Region, Calabarzon, and Central Luzon, because this would make up 70% of the financial epicenter of the country. And then, and once we are okay with vaccinating 70% of the financial and educational and business centers in National Capital Region, Calabarzon, and Central Luzon, then we should actually then focus on other hotspot area, particularly Davao or Cebu. But to spread thinly the vaccine, surely we will reach 3 to 5 years. But if we want to be agile, we can accomplish this in 2 years if we will focus on the financial epicenter. And of course, economic recovery is actually would mean herd immunity. And herd immunity, because of vaccination of 70% of the population, will lead to normalcy and, of course, faster economic recovery.
Now, while all of this is going on, Doctor, this is what are the other health issues that we cannot drop the ball on with or without COVID?
Well, the number one problem still in the Philippines, two-thirds of cases would be non-communicable diseases. 66% of the conditions afflicting the Filipinos would be smoking-related and alcohol-related, stroke, heart attack, cancer, and chronic obstructive lung diseases, and of course, diabetes. We should not drop the ball here. After the COVID, we'll still be facing this kind of situation. But since we are actually in a pandemic, and of course not actually addressing the non-communicable diseases, this will be a problem of you know, of gigantic proportions. You have here a surge of cardiovascular cases, and then you have a surge of COVID cases. That will be a nightmare for our healthcare.
As you said, herd immunity is equivalent to economic recovery. And there's the rub. With that, thank you so much, Dr. Tony Leachon, public health reform advocate. We appreciate you sharing your insights with us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.